Alrighty then. Welcome to the Dr. Kicklighter review. I'm sure you've all by now turned your phones off because you know how I get very angry about that. Okay, Wisdom Wednesday, October 17th, that's tomorrow. Ollie members and guests are invited to attend Wisdom Wednesday lecture from 2:30 to 4 right here on the stage at the Jewel Collins Smith, the beautiful Jewel Collins Smith Museum. This week, Greg Williams will present the Auburn Equestrian Team National Champions again. Perhaps we could interest the coaching staff into football. Just a thought. I don't know. Maybe they have an interest. All right, well, you know, quite honestly, the rest of this stuff you've all heard like 15 times, so I don't care. You know, many people feel that history is a mystery. And perhaps we need a great detective to unravel the dark mystery of times long past. Well, you know, I was thinking about that, and maybe, you know, who comes to mind? Well, Dick Tracy's kind of cool, but nah, I don't think so. Of course, we have the great Belgian detective, Hercule Poirot, a quality guy, great detective. But you know what? We need the absolute best we can get. So, I give to you a man who only lacks a deerstalker cap, the Sherlock Holmes of history, Dr. Joseph Kicklighter.
Thank you, Frank. You never know. Never know where this will lead. Just as in Germanic times, we never could determine where European leadership would lead. That's a segue. And here is our number one candidate. Let's recall, shall we, from last week, during the 6th century, lots and lots of Germanic peoples, so many that I won't bother to go over them because many of them did not make, shall we say, a permanent impression on European history. Many of them came and were absorbed by others. But here we have in purple those that were supposed to dominate. Maybe one of those small facts of history you never knew before. Because you say, Ostrogoths? I know little to nothing about Ostrogoths. Why should I care about Ostrogoths? You're right. They are lost in the mysteries of history, as the brilliant Frank just pointed out. It's like, it's very, very odd. And seriously, they did take over Italy. They were led by a great king. They were very much imbued with classical civilization. Their leader was a man named Theodoric. As an Ostrogoth, he had at one point been a hostage in Constantinople for the behavior of the people. You know, in other words, y'all can stay as long as you act like you're supposed to. And while your prince is over here, he can have Greek lessons and maybe get to read the Iliad and the Odyssey and do a lot of things that any nice Ostrogothic lad might find unusual, I think. But ultimately, the Byzantines sort of commissioned the Ostrogoths to come into Italy. Remember, this is after 476. That's our big year. We have the last Roman emperor in the West. Nobody's going to forget 476. Nobody in this room. No, indeed. 476 is one of those years. And I'll bring that up again just in case. 476. But there he is in purple, ruling over all those areas. Italy was, of course, the heart of the Roman Empire at one time. Those are great memories. But they are memories. In fact, now Ostrogoths rule over a native Italian population, but they're still divided. Rome itself is not where Theodoric will have his seat. It will be up in Ravenna, and I know many of you all have been there. It's just a nice drive down from Venice. So you all can take that to go to Ravenna, and that will be his headquarters, as it will be the Byzantine headquarters later on. But right now, it'll be the Ostrogothic center, and you'll say, well, is that important? And I think it is. I think it was strategically very important when you look at how much the Ostrogoths were going to rule over. And he was up there. And of course, by this point, we'll be talking about it shortly, Rome is going to be more or less ruled by the head of the Catholic Church. And this individual thought it would be a good idea. They live in different cities. And you say, but why? Why shouldn't we be together? He ain't heavy. He's my brother. Not really, because Theodoric is, yes, a heretic. He lives the life of heresy day in, day out. These Ostrogoths deny the Trinity. Yep. Understand that. It's hard for then the Ostrogoths and the local folk, the Italians, to exactly get along. You know how you work with them, but then Friday afternoon you say, oh, I'll see you, I'll see you Monday. Because you know you're going to a different church. Where they go, nobody says Trinity, okay? And so, isn't it? It's amazing to me to think how the Ostrogoths and Italians maintain this sort of separate life. Because, you know, some lovely Italian girl comes home and says, oh, Mama, I met the most wonderful boy. He said, sorry, honey, no dating an Arian. Well, how could you? I mean, you know, dating heretics? I think not. You want your children to be Arians? No. So they are, in essence, like two societies. But you can still work with the Arians. Meaning that they are his administrators, Theodoric, the king. And you have all these people around him, buzz around. Sir, can we write all that down? Because they're the literate people, these Catholics. And they're looking at him and saying, let me get all that down. I've got the memos. I'll get them out to everybody. Of course, you know you're going to hell. But back to business. So it's very interesting, this Arian versus Catholic issue. And it will not work out well, despite the fact that during much of the period, 6th century, early, late 5th, early 6th, it will work. Unfortunately, he may have had issues that we would classify as sort of neurotic, very suspicious, gradually of his advisors, you know, perhaps they were trying to slip something in his drink and have some sort of Byzantine upheaval, you know, that kind of thing. So ultimately, it will not end well. But for a long time, he will maintain a policy of trying to preserve as much as he could of Roman grandeur in the classical world. But it didn't work out. However, for him, it did. This is Superboy of Catholicism, Clovis. For you in the room who are going to say, but if you drop that C, you would have Louis. Yes, you would, French lovers. because you understand, Clovis is going to be our hero. He's not necessarily a hero in the sense of a saint, because he was barbarian. He was a Frank, and there's no way that one can pretend otherwise. I called him rude, crude, and ambitious. That's somebody brought up Machiavelli before class. Yes, I think he's very Machiavellian, and of course, there's a bit of The Sopranos in this, Godfather. He understood that for him to get power over all of the Franks who were in Central Europe and moving southward, you know, into what is Gaul or France today, that he would need to take many steps that weren't necessarily pleasant to people with whom he might have had pretty good relations. But it's all temporary in obtaining his goals. One interesting thing to note about Franks and certain other peoples, like Angles and Saxons, they never had the taint of Arianism. They remained pure pagan, okay? They went straight from paganism. They loved their idols. They brought them with them wherever they went, idols to go. They were there. And it just kills me to think that Clovis married a Catholic. And you think, what's a nice Catholic girl marrying a man like that? Well, that's politics. Her family happened to be neighbors, and it was thought it would be a wonderful match. And I hope after the honeymoon, he thought so too. Because, as many of you of the Catholic persuasion will be aware, there would always be the question of the children. And of course, the question of, you're kind of big and mean, and I know Visigoths are afraid of you. Think that's going to work for you after you're dead? And sometimes that doesn't go over too well. But this woman who goes by the name of Clotilde was very firm in her Catholicism. So it's not a question of like, saying, honey, would you like to be a pagan? Have you seen some of my gods here? I'd like to. No, they're not. It's like you do your thing, I'll do my thing religiously. And I just find that very interesting that a man like this would have done it. That's what the story is. Well, they settled. And then he said, I think I want to be like my wife. Every day. They must have studied, you know, confirmation classes, studied the seven sacraments and talked about theories of papal supremacy. I'm not exactly sure, but by going straight from paganism to Catholicism, as you see by the, with this most impressive ceremony as imagined, which I'm sure is correct, very imaginary, we can see that the Catholic Church pulled out all the stops. And you know what the Catholic Church is saying? We got one. Yeah. And we didn't have to wait for him to be one of those you-know-what Arians. He came straight to us. We do have certain sources, and this is my favorite, because according to this story in the Chronicle, he had been faced with a battle with Arians. And it's bad to have to beat up on Arians or get Arians beat up on you, you know, Arians versus pagans. Then he says to the Catholic God, he says, my wife told me about you. You sound really big, really bad. How do you feel about losers like my enemies? And the God says, if you want to find out, join my team. Clovis says, I'm up for it. And you know what happens to those Arian Visigoths? Dying like flies, falling off the horses. Yes. You mean Arians are losers? Yes. I'm sorry. Sorry. This is the record, though. You can see there. See, he brings up his wife's name dropper to God. I pledge you perpetual service, if only you'll now give me the victory. Instantly. Okay? Even back then, they were in the instant. They want, no, we're not going to wait long weekend or something like that. Nope. Instantly, when he said, his men were filled with burning valor and a great fear, smote. When fear smites you, you better watch out. So they were moving, and they turned their backs and fled the battle. The Alemanni, Germanic people, I thought you'd like that term, they yielded. They said, you know, it's not worth it. I don't know if they're singing like peace songs or reaching out and saying, but they understand we were really way off. It's no use in going on. You are the winners. And he said, well, good luck to you all. I've got to get back to my studies. I'm learning more about the Gospels and St. Paul's letters, so see you for maneuvers next year. But basically, it is a dramatic event. And it's not just something, you know, for papal news, flash, we've got one. It's not like that so much as it's to understand that the historians of this period, you know, contemporaries, often say, by choosing this, they choose the side that they thought would be most beneficial to them. And it so happens that all groups who went the other way will find themselves defeated. Oh, it may be the Byzantines, or it may be the Arabs. Whoever it is, this will be the group that prevail on the continent. The Franks, under originally Clovis. And ultimately, this will be the kingdom that will produce the greatest medieval king of all, Charlemagne. So, who becomes a kind of Catholic emperor, if you will, of the Frankish and other people. So I really don't think it can be overestimated. So, where do we go? Well, you see, we say goodbye Ostrogoths. They are going to no longer be in the picture by the 7th century. At the same time, you'll notice in Spain, we still have the Visigoths, but they won't be here much longer. They too will be departing. Even though they convert from Arianism to Catholicism, too late, to make the cut, and believe me, there's going to be a cut. And of course, I'm referring to the coming of the Islamic religion and the Arab people. Meanwhile, the Anglo-Saxons over in Britain are going to have their own conversion, and so they don't have to go through that experience of Arianism. On the other hand, they will have their own experience with Celtic Christianity. But it is a different one, simply to note that the Franks are going to become the Germanic people who will help to produce the Western civilization that, combined with the earlier aspects we discussed, the Roman traditions and the Christian church. So this is that third element, the Frankish people. Now, what's going on in the East? So we turned to the Byzantines, who are contemporary of this period. If you had called them Byzantines, they would turn around and say, "Who are you talking about? What Byzantines?" Yeah, that's one of those odd things we learn in history, that we use terms that they didn't use back then. Someone in modern centuries, maybe Gibbon, probably even earlier than Gibbon, got the idea of calling the Eastern Romans Byzantines, associated with the original name of Constantinople, or Byzantium. But Byzantines always called themselves Romans, and don't you forget it. We are Romans. They had that sense of self. We are Romans. We are the perpetuators of Roman civilization. And it's always fascinating when you think about that, because so many of us, I guess, think, well, 476, thank you. I just want to make sure. I just need that affirmation. Yeah, I appreciate that. That after that, Rome's gone. Well, it isn't. Don't say that in front of a Greek. That would be very hurtful. But they consider themselves to be the second Rome and the perpetuator of that civilization. But as we know, that is not all the truth. There is more to the story, because they don't have the whole Roman Empire, even though they try to get what was once the Roman Empire and no longer is. They try to get it, but they never succeed. And that's why this colorful pair, Justinian and Theodora, colorful is a word for it, try to be nice, they will play such a major role in the 6th century Byzantine Empire. And why is that significant? Because Justinian was the last emperor of the East who will know, yes, Carol, Latin. It's a time of more, yeah, if you need Kleenex, I'll understand. If you need to, you know, the tears coming down, I can just imagine. What? No conjugations, no pluperfect passive? Yes, it's a hard and sad time. Because, folks, we are going Greek, and we are going Greek in the biggest way as far as this empire is concerned. This fascinates me. The light color would indicate the Eastern Roman lands, and again, I'm sure the map makers are taking liberties, but we won't let it we won't let it worry us or report them to a Bureau of Cartography and get them in trouble. But let's just say it was more or less what you see today. And I would say, and I think you would agree, that these are parts of the world that are troubled in contemporary times. I don't think I'll get a debate on that. But this, as you see, would include much of southeastern Europe, including Greece itself, and it would include modern-day Turkey and Syria, Lord, and then Israel and Jordan and so forth and so on, all the way up through Egypt. And you'll say, why does the color change? Well, you can just spell it Vandal, because it's V-A-N-D-A-L-S. Yes, those areas in northern Africa are now ruled by Vandals. They took it over. They came south. And they managed to cross over. It's kind of interesting to think about how they learned to sail, how they became sailors. By the virtue of the fact that the language has given us the idiom Vandalism, the reputation of the Vandals has not been a good one in history. And you say, did we invite them to Mass? Were they Pope lovers? I think not. They were Arians. Bite my tongue. And so what about all the nice Catholics in Northern Africa? Oppression, abuse, etc. And the reason I know that is because I've got the Catholic sources to describe it. Do they get point, counterpoint? Are there any Vandal sources? I think not. They are all, of course, about the Catholic martyrs to these nasty Vandalarians. You know, and you'd like to read about, what about, you have Vandalarian youth services, or do they go scouting? Never, not in one. It's all these nice Catholics doing all these great activities. And you say, what about the Arian youth? No, they are wicked, demonic folk. Okay, so we know that they have eternal problems. Okay, so much for the Vandals. Let's go then north, and we are into Iberia, aka Spain and Portugal, and that's going to be Visigothic. More problems as far as Arianism is concerned. Arians ruling over a native Catholic population. And of course, we've already talked about Italy, so we're aware that is going to be Ostrogothic and Arian ruled as well. That's merely a review, basically, of some of the various Germanic people. And then, in what's Istanbul today, the great second Rome, Constantinople, there are rulers thinking to themselves, but it's all mine. Why shouldn't I have it all? Tossing and turning, you know, that sort of thing. You might say to them, but you got so much already. Because look at all that. That's a nice empire, isn't it? See, I want it all. Yeah, and there is no doubt that the people we're going to talk about did have those kinds of concerns. Counseling would have been really, really good for Justinian. And just have said to him, look, be satisfied. This is a great empire you have. But your budget, you know, you've got taxes, and, you know, bring in the imperial economists and said, let's just let it be. But no, we want it all. And he did pretty well. These are the areas. We do a before and after. These are the areas that are in that hideous lime green that will be retaken by the Byzantines. not for long. Kind of like a library book, isn't it? It's sort of like you're going to have it, and you can say, this is Byzantine. Well, it will for a while. Some Greeks are going to move over there. Greek is, you know, isn't going to be important. But not for long. So that is an interesting phase to understand how tumultuous this particular time period is. And we are talking about the period before it gets even more tumultuous because of the coming of the Muslim religion and the Arabs. Big change is ahead. And I always like to tell students that it is fortunate that we don't know the future, because we normally have quite enough to think about just dealing with the present, and the future can take care of itself. But if you had been someone in that particular time spot, they couldn't have imagined how the world is about to change in which they live. Now, a few obvious facts. This is the Hellenistic world, and of course it had been taken and Romanized by the Romans. When? Well, I'd say the first century before Christ, the first and second century, that's when it was conquered. Much of that territory comes late in the game as far as imperialism is concerned. You know, this is to go back a little bit into classical history, a lot of this, the remains of the kingdoms, they were formed by Alexander the Great's conquests. And now all of this will be absorbed by the Romans, because you know what go-getters they were. So all of that will be taken. And as it is Romanized, I guess one would say, they become very proud of being part of that. And as the West collapses, 476 and after, we are aware that this is becomes the Roman Empire. I mean, there's an irony in that. I think you would agree. But this is the part that brings in most of the money and urban population and advancement. Because what happened in the West? Well, it's wrecked. They got a lot of development ahead. Let's put it that way. The East, then, is the advanced part. I think that's less developing part is in the West. And the East is very developed in their terms. Now, you see the cities all well known to readers of the Bible. For example, Antioch, which had been a city named for one of the great Hellenistic rulers. You know, taking the example of Alexandria, these rulers were not modest. Oh, shucks, we can't call it that. I'd be so embarrassed. I mean, you know, I've dreamt of a Kicklighterville. I know it's wrong, but I mean, I can have my private thoughts. You know, it's that sort of fantasy of grandeur. And Antioch went on to be, as you're aware, a very great city in the Christian world, as these others did too, including Alexandria and Jerusalem and Constantinople. In fact, then, all of this is to note that this, as far as the ancient world is concerned, is a much more urban setting. But that should not be exaggerated. In the East as well as the West, most folks live in the country, and that just needs to be often remembered. I always say this whole thing about people living in towns and cities and so forth, that's not in my period, okay? That's way after me and my time, okay? That's centuries ahead. You want that? Take a course in the 18th and 19th century, right? I mean, it's not going to happen now. But these are some of the great cities of the period, and they were all, quote unquote, Byzantine. And that, of course, is going to be very important, in part because of language and culture, but also because of, you guessed it, religion. You mean you got Arians sneaking around? Well, they're academics. They most hang out and go on breaks and read papers to each other. And, you know, it's more like that kind of thing. Arius, in fact, the leader of this was from Alexandria, and he was an academic, and you can just imagine, and he denying the Trinity and all of the little Arian minions all being very excited. That's the truth, though. If Arianism had not spread to the Germans, I probably wouldn't be raving on like this. It probably would have ended up in some sort of somebody not getting tenure and then leaving the University of Alexandria in some sort of snit and saying they didn't like me or something. But the fact is that there were other heresies too. I mean, Constantinople, Alexandria, these cities are full of what you would call intellectuals. And, of course, you know, in this kind of society, their favorite topic is Christian thought. And where you get people like this together, they're going to want to debate. And so that is important for us to bear in mind, that there is a lot of thought going on, and much of it dealing with Christianity. Now, if you recognize what you see before you, it is because this is from Ravenna. And it is very, very famous. Because when you're in Ravenna and you go to this church of San Vitale, you feel like you are in a Greek house of worship. I mean, it is quite filled with reminders of their Greek period, shall we call it? So, why was this so? Well, that is what we're going to see. But before we do, let us note again that an issue that still is with us, and I'm guessing it's not going to be solved. I guess we just, you know, one time I thought, I think it was back in the 60s when maybe it was Paul VI met with a metropolitan or the primate, they had a big kiss and a hug. But hugging and kissing doesn't create one church, does it? And so it does not appear that this particular rift is going to end. That means Orthodox versus Catholic. They are both Christian, but thanks to custom, culture, and history, they are apart. One recognizes papal supremacy, and the Orthodox saying, he's high, but not quite that. The whole process, then, of separation began as much about culture, language, and, of course, the Pope, than it did about any doctrine. Now, you would never go up to a member of the Orthodox faith and said, "Are you an Arian or something?" "No, no, no. They are Trinity all the way." Okay? No problem. But again, this has to do with culture and the papacy. There are other issues, but that's enough for us. That this is Greek versus Latin, sorry, and recognition of papal authority. To use a Latin phrase, if I may, primus inter pares, do you like that? First among equals. They kind of say, well, maybe you could be that, but that's all you're getting. Because these other fellows who are Constantinople, Jerusalem, Alexandria, and Antioch, big five, they would have preferred it just to be like a five of them and we're the top. But Rome says, no, you're not. And I've just brought you up to 2018. I don't think any change is going to come anytime soon. Now, the Eastern Emperor was recognized as also a major figure because the Eastern, well, should I just call him Roman Emperor, was a Christian. And it wasn't as if he were some Johnny-come-lately. That was, remember, that was Constantine. That's been since the 4th century. In case you've been somewhere the last century or two, we're up to the 6th century, so they're used to being Christian. So are they just regular Christians? Hi, regular Christian. No, they are the emperor. Yes. In other words, you get down and you honor them. There's God, then there's emperor. And that, of course, is going to create some interesting dynamics, as we will see. Now, Justinian. Justinian can't really say, but they often do, "My family, we've been Roman emperors for a long, long time." No, they weren't. His uncle had been emperor before him. I think his uncle was named Justin and was somewhat effective in the battlefield and had taken the throne. You say, you mean he just usurped authority? Yes, it happens. Do we talk about it? Do we go over the details? No. The family is never mentioned again. You are just holy one. You are great. We love you. Can we kiss your big foot? You know, that's basically what happened. Once you take power, there's no looking back. Could we have a retrospective, you know, from where you get? No, I am just the ruler. Justinian had served him. Justin, as far as I'm aware, must have been childless. So Justinian now becomes ruler as his nephew. And as he does so, he will both rule longer and he will rule more aggressively. He was, after the ruler from 527 to 565, that's much of the 6th century. So he would have a long range. If you ask me where he's from geographically, you'd probably call it Eastern Europe today, over in probably what is Hungary, over there. He did know Latin, and Latin was used to his court, most importantly. That is an interesting note, just to be aware when you think about Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta is just about ready to come, and you think, not at this court, not yet. But people around him are probably saying, yeah, we'll get rid of all those Latin books soon enough. You know, because those Greeks are coming to take over. Not yet. But, I mean, let's face it. This is a Greek environment if you stop and think about it. Now, if many of you are wondering, but everybody's not Greek. Aren't there a lot of folks that are, Egyptians and all these other, yeah, but that doesn't. They are not part of the ruling clique. Latin spoken here, Greek spoken here, the rest of the languages are not in use if you are part of the ruling groups. And we do understand that. They will have their day, just like with the English. But right now, the Latins are in charge, and you'll do it our way. Okay? So it's linguistically rather confining, but it's good to bear in mind that Greek is on the way. It is coming as the language both of religion and of government. As for the remainder, he was a man who had many military problems. And you say, Slavs, but they're lovely people. Slavs are good people. Well, their ancestors could sometimes get excited, and they, like their German friends, wanted to come south without an invitation. And so he will deal with this. See, that's kind of interesting to think about. You say, why didn't the Germans come east? Well, the Eastern Emperors kind of talked to the leaders of the Germans and said, why don't y'all go over there, go over west? Those areas are mighty fine over there, and I think you all could find some good homes. And the Germans go, well, thanks for the advice. We think we'll, yeah, okay, that sounds great. But that's the Germans. And now here come the Slavs. And they can't go. See, the Germans are already there. We don't want Germans and Slavs fighting. So the Slavs come south. And as they do, of course, they are going to have to deal with, or the Byzantines are going to have to deal with them, aren't they? Because somehow they are going to have to be settled, the Slavic peoples. Meanwhile, of course, there are the Persians. Yes, the Iranians of today were a major force in the ancient world. The Persians were on a new period in their history. You said, but I thought they were defeated by Alexander the Great. Well, that was then. We've had a revival. We're sort of on a Persian Renaissance, shall we say. And so this means that if you are in what we call Persia, where do you want to go? Well, you want to go west. And that means you want to go in the Byzantine Empire. And the Byzantines want to go east into the Persian Empire. So we meet unpleasantly, okay? And that is to be borne in mind. You say, well, we've already got these Slavic problems. Well, we have a variety of issues, don't we? We got Slavs. We got Persians. And lest we forget, we've got Germans. I mean, it's not like everybody's happy. In fact, it's hard to see that anybody is happy. When I think about Justinian and ruling over these people, you think all those Egyptians are going there, this is great. We heart Byzantium, you know, it's sort of like, I don't think so. I think it's like everyone, it seems, except for the Justinian and his many sycophants. Yes, there were lots and lots of people around him who were kissing those cheeks many times daily. Because Justinian, you say, but he was just a man. Well, not to him. He was God's agent on earth. And God had a lot of conversations with him. And you know what he told Justinian? He would say, Justinian, he said, yes, sir. I said, do you mind going and conquering Italy and Northern Africa? It just grieves me that those territories are not ruled by the Romans. And Justinian says, well, sir, if that's what I need to be doing, count me in. I'm going to be there. And I'm going to be here when you complete your breaks. Okay? 4.5 minutes. Yeah, Frank's power. He is Frank's power. He's like head of the Imperial Guard. He's like the Praetorian Guard. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. Are we ready now? Okay, we're ready now. Oh, yeah. The sixth century is going to be gone and you'll miss it. Come on now. And you'll be mighty sad. That just gets by us. It's like 476. We won't. Can we ever forget that? That's a year. That was the year. Yeah, could you imagine that New Year's Eve when. For here's to 477, everybody goes, nah, nobody cares. No more Roman emperors. Yeah. Auld Lang Syne. I mean, it's like, would be tough. So, let's get with these Byzantines and recall as we do so that the Byzantines, by the time of Justinian, and note, I begin to use the term with Justinian because, remember, prior to that, the idea of a separate empire is really not where I want to go. If we think about 476, and then we think about when does the Byzantine Empire really begin, well, it doesn't, does it, except in the minds of history folk. Nobody announces, you know, here's to the Byzantine Empire and all the wonderful Greek opportunities that are ahead. We know it didn't happen that way. But only after there is no longer a Roman emperor in the West can we have the sense of, I guess, what we could call a new identity. And that identity focused on classical civilization, Greek as well as Latin, and the concerns that we've expressed here of military issues, Slavs included, as well as, of course, those darn Persians that keep wanting to push westward. Yeah. So, that's plenty to keep Justinian busy, but he had much else. And one of his interests, in addition, was, of course, the glorious Empress Theodora. Theodora is one of the most remarkable women in the ancient world that we know about. It's so often the case that women of this fascinating character are not portrayed very well. That is, we hear very little about them, but we hear a lot about Theodora, a lot. And that, of course, is partially because, what's the nice word, controversial. She had an interesting life. Cut short, but she was, in fact, a major player. And sometimes that does seem curious that in this period, in the Byzantine Empire, a woman like Theodora, who died years before Justinian, she died in 548, He never remarried, and he lived until 565. And you think, though, up until her death, she was probably the person who determined much of the policies of the Byzantine government. Now, if I were to tell you that she came from a high imperial background, I would be a liar. I would be telling you filthy lies, and you would go out and I would be discredited and ruined. But instead, I can tell you that she came from a more exotic background. I would call it Carny World. What they always said in the movies, you know, they are carny folk. Yes, and so that always meant that when they came to town, you know, those of us who were small towners, you always, you know, at school, when you went to school, you say, I wonder if we're going to see some of the carnival people. You know, because this was always very exciting in our small burgs to know that the folk were about. And if it is true that her father, he was a bear tamer and she was a dancer, that may well have been true. How did they meet? Well, it is said that she also had social responsibilities, that she was busy, as we say in academia, with extracurricular activities. And she met many people who were serving their nations, serving their countries, military. She not so interested in the civilians, but more the military. And that's how... Didn't I express that euphemistically? Okay, yes. So she and Justinian apparently became friends as a result of his military experience and his penchant for games of chance. And apparently that's how they became friends. Okay, so you say, you mean it was sordid? A bit lurid? Yes, but you're not supposed to talk about that, because I think if somebody left a sign at the palace, Theodora has a pass, I would say that would not be good for your future. I think during her life, once he became emperor, that Theodora was so powerful that no one would have mentioned anything about her. It is amazing to me, though, and we'll never know all the details about how she was able to learn all that she knew. This could not have been an individual who was even literate, but she knew enough to argue theology, to determine policies of the government, and he rather passively obeyed. One doesn't get the sense of a discussion, but of her power. But that makes it very interesting. Procopius wrote a tell-all book, in case, you know, if you think about inquiring minds want to know, in our own day, we think sometimes of Procopius' secret history as a sort of start to this. Who's going to tell us what was going on behind the scenes? Well, Procopius does it, but he waits for publication until Theodora dies in 548. Smart man. He had good life insurance, to be sure, but why push it? So he waited. He said, is she cold yet? I mean, is she really gone? Is she really dead? Making sure. Then 549, get that book out. Procopius' secret history tells in lurid detail, which may or may not be true, about her as she supposedly was. Put her on the stage. Yes, drama. Yes, drama is quite the place for career-minded individuals. Courtesans. It's not a word you hear a lot anymore, is it? But what could be better than being a courtesan? But she couldn't even play the flute or the harp. That's all she could. Nor was she even trained to dance, but gave her youth to anyone she met. Mm-mm-mm. Her general favors included actors. But look at the end. At least we get a nice compliment. But she was very funny and a good mimic. So she was a lot of fun, a lot of screen. Now, again, this is post 548, okay? No question, she's dead. She's really very, very dead. And then, because you wouldn't have put stuff like this about the empress. Procopius was not just an insignificant person either. He'd been at the court. He was a historian. He was very close to military authorities. And maybe he'd had a beef with Theodora and he's just writing this hateful tract, but it is really, really nasty. To her body, she gave even greater care than this. And I'm thinking, did you follow her around to check the bathtub and see how much bubble bath she had? If less than she thought was off, early she entered the bath and late she left it, and having bathed, went to breakfast. After breakfast, she rested. At dinner, and she partook on every kind of food and drink, and many hours she devoted to sleeping. I'm thinking, how did she run the Byzantine Empire like this? Though she wasted her hours thus intemperately, what time of day remained she deemed ample for managing the Roman Empire. And you can just hear him then say, tut, tut, you know. But if all of this is true, that she comes from this common background and that she lived very much in circumstances that would not have been appropriate for a person who was ruling an empire with many problems, she is certainly a fascinating character, and it does seem that after her death, he sort of lost his grip, and the rest of the reign is not a happy one. Now, we do, of course, as those of you been there know, we still have this wonderful relic of his period. Not counting the minarets, because this was built to be what was, at that time, the greatest Christian religious structure there was, including St. Peter's at the time, could not have compared in scope. It does have an interesting history. Becoming a Muslim house of worship after the Turks conquered the city in the 15th century. But it had been Orthodox. And finally, in the 20th century, they turned it into what is today a museum and a very beautiful one. But the building of this great religious edifice would indicate, Saint Sophia would indicate that he understood the basis of his authority. And that is that, as I've said several times, God is big king and I'm little king. But don't ever forget that. And that fellow in Rome with all of his pope talk, he's okay too, but he needs to remember his place. And that's a problem. There's some issues there. And needless to say, these issues are not going to be solved. But understand that I doubt with all of his other concerns, this was necessarily a major issue. The popes of his day were probably of the sort that would have said, well, I realize we have differences, but I think we can work together. I would say we can be diplomatic when we need to be. Remember, we're still in Latin, and that brings the warmth and comfort. I mean, he'd come up and said, what are you saying? You need to speak to me in Greek, you Pope fella. But yeah, that would have been hurtful. But since they were still Latin buddies, I guess there were some of that when the occasion came up. But I'm telling you, I doubt they would hang out together that much. Because remember, the Pope's in Rome, and Lord knows he's got enough troubles. Plenty of troubles. Plenty of troubles. Ostrogothic troubles. I mean, how would you like? I mean, dealing with people who are Arians? Yeah. I mean, are they going to say, oh, we respect you so much? Indeed not. I mean, they consider, a lot of how bad it was. So let's just say that one of his great accomplishments was the creation of Hagia Sophia. Now you say, was that in the budget? Well, I think that's what they call a budget buster, okay? It was very expensive, and you can sell a lot of Krispy Kremes, and you can raise money, but I think that would take a big old hefty tax levy to raise that. And you say, but I thought our defense budget was right high. Because, yes, we've got some serious expenses. We are very dependent on the taxpayer. Very dependent. Taxpayers are called upon to do a lot of duties. And of course, that is never popular, is it? You may have seen this before, this particular printing, and you see there the Muslim structures. I imagine that would be in about the 16th century, much, much later, obviously, than the period with which we are concerned, because, of course, there was not an Islamic religion at this particular time. But it is quite a structure, and as many of you know who've been to Turkey, you will be aware of that. It's a great national treasure for them. And historically for us as well. Other aspects of the reign, again, so much, it seems to me, involve financial issues because Constantinople had not been updated since it was created in the 4th century, and you can only imagine what disrepute it had been allowed to come into during those years. A lot of people don't realize they really created it to be an authentic replica of Rome. So you think, well, that would take a lot. Yes, I'm sure it did. And then when it goes, because of all the other concerns, they had to spend, apparently they were willing, to rebuild it, not the original Rome, which had even worse problems, because you know they've had a lot of guests. Remember the visitors, the Sacks, you know? Tourist sites, but no paying, yeah. So that was 410. Not that I want to push dates on you, but that 5th century is a busy, hard time for Sacks and Fallings and all of that. So Constantinople has urban renewal, and that's Justinian and Theodora. We never forget the Roman law code. This particular, I just don't know how people could have done what they did, and it's so amazing to think about all of these legal experts must have come together. Justinian didn't do it, obviously. But from the early days of the Republic, remember the 12 tables of law? You go all the way back. Think, did they have big old filing cabinets? Because, you know, they didn't have it all like we do. But all of those records, and you have all these legal professors. Could you imagine all the fussy folks getting together and say, well, what do you think this means? Oh, Lord, I'm sorry I asked. But this is what we call the codification of Roman law. And you say, is that a large project? Well, I think so. Centuries worth of legal traditions. You say, ooh, makes my head hurt. Yes, the Corpus Juris Civilis, the body of civil law, was one of the greatest legal codifications ever produced. And it will be so for the empires of the future, as well as for, guess who? The church. Yes, the Catholic Church, the popes, saying, why can't we have our law code? And they do. Caris Juris Canonici, body of canon law. So it's interesting, the Romans and the Catholic Church, those law codes. So that is under Justinian. I guess you have to pay all those professors, or maybe that just goes on as part of their activity extension, or perhaps goes on their resume. I don't know. They get credit for it anyway. But so now back to heretics. You thought, not Arians again. No, these are new ones. Monophysites. And you say, oh, no, not them, yes. They are hanging out in Egypt. Monophysites, they say, represent a discontent among Egyptians and Syrians with Byzantine rule. That's one theory. It's an interesting theory that we express our discontentment with rulers by going heretic. I don't know if that's the way I would choose, but Monophysites clearly are individuals who cannot accept Christ as both divine and human in nature. Oh, they accept he looked like a human. He looked like it, but he wasn't really. I remember I had a religion professor in college said, well, then who is that suffering up on the cross? But that is not something that the Monophysite was willing to admit to. The Monophysite insisted that the divine could not become human in nature. I know, and that's kind of hard to think of. You can look human, but that doesn't mean you really are. You say, well, all right, pour us another cup of coffee and we'll talk that over. No, I don't think so. You get out of the coffee room and no more classes for you. We don't want your kind in our building. This business of separating off people, you say, but I thought that was going on elsewhere. Well, Egypt and Alexandria become a center of it. And you say, but it's not allowed. Well, I know, but they'll come out and speak out, and they have their followers, these Monophysites. Well, again, this becomes now an issue of persecution, because you can't scream me First Amendment. I express my rights about the natures of Christ. No, you don't. You shut your mouth. And so you're going to have a major issue. So that's interesting. And I don't know, you think about Theodora being involved in this. It's hard to determine whether Theodora might have been trying to pull him back and say, let him be, because most of these movements, they're really cool for a while, and You know, they'll get all these supporters, and everybody will say, I love Monophysites and all that. And then the next week, they come and they go, these fads. But it appears that Justinian really found it hard. It hurt his feelings, I think. You know, it's like, why don't you love me? It was really human, you know. So movements of this sort just seemed to grate on him, and so he tended to be repressive. And this would be true of any other group of heretics, because my religion is the religion. And if you don't follow it, and you say, well, we just have that difference, but I'm crazy about you. No, you're not crazy about me. You just say you're crazy about me because you deny his full human nature. You Monophysite, you. And so you can't come to my party next week. So they have a real hard time with the Monophysites, and I just find that very interesting. And of course, you say, well, Jews, but what's wrong with them? Well, again, they've been there all this time, and it just seems like anybody who is not of that Orthodox faith offend him. Even though they've always been there, even though they're monotheists, anti-Semitism is a sure sign that there is discontent during this sixth century. And that's one part of his policy. Now, Justinian decided, and we are told this in various works, that he had dreams that God told him to retake the West because the West belonged to him, I mean, to the empire. I confuse them sometimes. And so basically, this will provide him with all the land. So he calls together, you know, a meeting of all the military council and says, fellas, you know, God spoke to me last night and said, we need to reconquer all the lands. He said, well, boss, we really were planning a Persian campaign, and, you know, those darn Slavs, we have to stay busy with them, and that's very costly. And so basically, this seems like something that they shouldn't have gotten involved in. But he's the emperor, and Theodore's backing him up. So early in his reign then, an army is dispatched to the west. And it must have been, as you can see, a massive campaign. They will retake lands that had been vandal. I personally think the population, the Catholic population, looked at these Byzantine armies as liberators. You know, D-Day, so August of 44, we're sort of glad you're here. Because they're not saying, oh, please let us have our vandals. We love vandals. No, we don't. We hate vandals. They're Arians. Yeah, you didn't forget. Okay, yeah, just a little reminder. They are bad, they vandalize, they hurt our feelings, and they deny the Trinity. They're losers, in short. So, vandals are going down, and then you'll notice we make it up by the Byzantine Navy into a bit of Iberia. And finally, oh boy, we hit a big old mess in Italy. The Italian wars, which will end Ostrogothic authority and begin a period of Byzantine rule in Italy and cause the beginnings of rules of another German people, who are named Lombards. And if that name sounds familiar, that's because Lombardy is part of northern Italy today. And that's the way those Italian folks got that blonde hair. Way back then, Lombardy became Germanic. and that has been an interesting ethnic part of Italian history. So, they will come to rule over all this territory, and you say, well, I guess debts are mounting. I think you could say that. I think you know the military can't function without a lot of support, right? And then we got, you have this great thing of marching through northern Africa and saying, Vandals, boo, Byzantines, yeah. I mean, it's not always that great. And the Italian campaign against the Ostrogoths is a very, very costly and difficult one that goes on for years. So, if you had had a RateMyEmperor.com, Justinian would have been having some low evaluations. That's just the way it is when you are the war emperor and you seem determined to take over all these areas. And of course you say, but he's not finished. Well, he might as well be, because that's pretty much all he's going to have. He does have a Byzantine headquarters there in Ravenna called an exarch, meaning he is the official, he represents the emperor from Constantinople. I'm sure he sends little messages or notes to the Pope. Hi, Pope, how you doing? Everything is great here in Ravenna. I hope y'all are having a good day in Rome. You know, it's like that, and it's kind of like, well, doesn't he tell him, you answer to my lord, the emperor, the emperor's number two, right after God. No, I think they just kind of cool it, you know, with that kind of thing. But it's there. It's just waiting. It's going to come out. But right now, he's in Ravenna, Pope's in Rome, and it is not a pleasant relationship, given the fact that the Byzantines have created some destruction in Italy, let's put it that way. Okay, so, and I told you that there were a new German people coming to town. They're called the Lombards. They had sort of been waiting. It's sort of like we are the new act in town. Once the Ostrogoths clear out, it says, oh, good, the theater is here. So they are moving south into Italy. And you say, well, can the Byzantines maintain themselves against them? Not really. Because the Byzantines have got, how does the cliche go? They've got a lot on their plate. That's it. They've got a lot on their plate, and we're talking militarily. And I don't mean just dealing with heretics. That too. But there's no doubt that as the Lombards come in and the amount of territory in Italy that the Byzantines actually concern, Justinian, now a widower after the 548 death of Theodora, will have much to contemplate as he spends his last years. Luckily for him, as for other rulers, they're not the ones the bill collectors come for, right? Because they're already dead. And then these people will come and say, remember when you had that campaign? I don't think we cleared that up, you know? And so that is a factor that will have to be borne in mind. As far as understanding the consequences for the empire in the future, it's to say that the empire was debt-ridden. Lots of people are going to be interested in taking what he had already had. The Persians are always anxious for a good fight. And they'll get it, Persians and Byzantines, Slavs, and a plague. I'm not saying the Slavs are a plague. I'm just saying that they were both a problem. the disputes of heretics creates and Jews creates more problems for the Persian government. And all of this, of course, during and after the life of Theodora. And finally, who do you suppose was born 5 years after the death of Justinian? The prophet Muhammad. And there we'll pick up next time. Thank you. Thank you.